जिंदाबाद।
Welcome to the world today. I'm Vikas Majeed Khan. Today we're talking about, rather we're remembering the carnage that took place in Quetta a year ago on the 8th of August, where over 50 lawyers lost their lives in a suicide attack that took place in the premises of the hospital after one of their colleagues was killed. We're going to talk about the National Action Plan and where Pakistan's war on terror now stands. We'll also talk about the incident that took place in Lahore yesterday, where a truck of fruit was laden with the explosives. The investigations are still ongoing. And then there was another an encounter between the counter-terrorism department and some militants in which four of them were killed. So all these things will be a part of our discussion. Let me introduce my guests in the studio. Joining me today, we have Javed Siddiq Saab, and along with him, we have AVM Ikramullah Bhatti Saab. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for being here. Sir, always the same question, you know, one never knows where to begin with this very unfortunate topic that we have chosen. But what can we do, sir, in these days and the way things are moving forward? Pakistan's war on terror seems to be getting more and more intense by the day. And then the specter of the Islamic State in our backyard in Afghanistan. Things seem to be very complicated, sir. Can you please help us make some sense out of this?
I think you're right to that extent, but Pakistan has really achieved huge successes in the war against terror. If you remember what was happening in this country 5, 6, 7, 10 years back, you know, almost on a daily basis there used to be explosions, there used to be suicide attacks, there used to be some unfortunate incident somewhere. But that has reduced significantly, particularly when this Operation Zarbaz was started in Pakistan. And since then, the incidents of terrorism and extremism and these suicide attacks in the cities of Pakistan have significantly reduced. So it's a big achievement on the part of Pakistan. But the other issue is that the military is doing well on its front, but the civilian part, I mean, the National Action Plan that you just mentioned in your intro, comprises of so many segments. It has so many aspects, and some of the duties or some of the functions have to be completed, done by the civilian administration as well. And there I think we find so many foibles, so many vulnerabilities. So I think we need to improve that. And there has been a demand on the part of the people, on the part of the security agencies, and on the part of the political parties as well, that the National Action Plan should be implemented in letter and spirit. And the former Prime Minister, you know, he was apprised of the situation on a number of occasions, and the government is being kept aware of what's happening, and they needed to do their job, which has not been done. So many organizations, many other agencies which had to be mobilized, they were not mobilized, and so therefore, you know, we find that there are so many weaknesses, so many gaps in the implementation of the National Action Plan. So that needs to be done. But on the front of military and the law enforcing agencies which are involved in, you know, in the operations against terrorists and militants in North, South Waziristan,
they have done a good job.
They have done a good job, and people are quite satisfied. But obviously, a lot more needs to be done.
Well, we're taking that forward, sir. AVM Saab, a lot more needs to be done. So if you could just start by enumerating the basic things where, in your opinion, the civilian government has been lagging in implementing the National Action Plan, the 20 points of that. What would you start with? What would be the first step in which you think that a lot more needs to be done?
I see we had 20 action points under the National Action Plan. A lot has happened, but a lot still has to be done. And to start with, the last of the 20 points somehow happens to be the most important one. and somehow nothing has happened about it. That is an improvement in our criminal justice system. And you see, after Zarbiaz, we moved on to Radd al-Fasad, and under that, nearly about 10,000 suspects were arrested. But only about 2.5 to 3% could be produced before the court. Similarly, we have arrested around 20,000 people in the matters of hate speech or spreading hate material, but only 16% of them could be produced before the courts. And then their conviction will be even minuscule. That actually dilutes the entire effect of the National Action Plan. And somehow, we as a country have not been able to improve our criminal justice system, which I think is one of the primary reasons of our not being able to totally eradicate terrorism. While a lot has happened, but this is something which has to be actioned on priority and taken till the very end. Else, these terrorist activities will continue to take place, although they have reduced in number and intensity many times over, but they still remain, they continue to haunt us. And out of the other similar points which have not been completed or fully followed up, for example, we had to implement FATA reforms. We have been talking about them, they have not happened. We were supposed to repatriate the Afghan refugees, that has not happened. And in Quetta, around 30% population is Afghan refugees, which gives a very safe sort of a safe haven or a refuge area for the terrorists from Afghanistan to come, reside, find facilitation, hide themselves and launch off from there. And that's a very, very large area, a very serious vulnerability. That is why we find that Quetta remains to be one of the big cities where we continue to have these terrorist activities off and on. And while we remember the incident where so many of our lawyers lost their lives, that was Quetta. And whereas we continue to focus on Islamabad, on Lahore, on Karachi, we want to turn them into safe cities, we want to improve our security arrangements, I think Quetta is a city almost as much as Peshawar, which needs to be equipped with such like facilities. And we need to, of course, turn that into a model safe city. And we need to focus on it. Although the population is very less compared to these other big cities, but the threat is probably the highest next to Peshawar. So that is something that we need to, of course, focus on. And the next aspect is, of course, is the change of national narrative. Although after the APS incident nearly 2.5-3 years ago, the nation got a jolt and we really understood the situation and the sympathies or the support that the terrorist organizations had within Pakistan started to diminish, but it still persists. So we need to develop that narrative, although the government, the media, the security agencies, the intelligentsia, they have been making efforts, but the fact remains that we are yet to develop a consensus national narrative against the terrorists and in support of our war on terrorism.
Absolutely.
That continues to be a weak area. And you see, whenever we want to fight terrorism with the support of security agencies or military agencies, the most important aspect in this is the intelligence that is required for such like operations. And while our intelligence agencies are there, it has to be the people of the country which have to be vigilant, which have to come out in support of such like efforts, in support of their intelligence agencies, and point out such like people. I mean, like we see, like we just learned that we had the incident in Lahore where a truck was parked for the last 3 days. And of course, it was waiting to happen. So that is where the role of public, the role of intelligence agencies comes in. And only then, you see, our efforts against these terrorists can become unified, can become strong, can become effective, and we can preempt these incidents or minimize their effect and succeed in eradicating them.
Right.
So I guess these are some of the areas where our national action plan is still lacking, and we need to focus more. Although we have almost as many subcommittees as are the action items, but I don't know these committees, how much have they been functioning, because there are quite a few areas where there's a lot still yet to be done.
Right. Sir Javed Saab, how much of this lack of implementation of the National Action Plan would you blame the civilian government's inertia or inefficiency to? Do you think that is the reason why it's not done? Or do you think that there's been so much political turmoil that we haven't had a steady government, or not all the political parties are on the same page when it comes to fighting terrorism? There are lots of question marks that are raised because of the ineptitude of the departments that are tasked with protecting the citizens.
When the National Action Plan was drawn up, it was done with the consensus of all political parties. I and you remember very well that conferences were held at the Prime Minister House in which all political parties participated. The security agencies, the military chiefs, they were there, and they put their hands together, you know, and heads together to draw up this plan, the National Action Plan. And all the details were actually discussed, and they were put on paper. But unfortunately, the civilian part of it, I mean, the responsibility which was tasked to the civilian government and the civilian agencies, they have not been done properly. For instance, my colleague has pointed out the system of criminal justice in Pakistan. One of the concerns was that the court system in Pakistan, or the process of law in this country, is not working, not functioning appropriately. That's why the military courts were created. To give punishment to terrorists, and so that, you know, these terrorists and extremists, they wouldn't be set free if they are caught in planning and executing their nefarious designs in Pakistan. So that was done very effectively, and it had a deterring effect on terrorists and extremists and their planning in Pakistan. But the other part, that the reforms that were to be brought about by the civilian side, by the legislation that was to be done, that has not been done. The NECTA, another very important organization in this whole scenario, is not active. It is not functioning. And it has been pointed out time and again that this organization needs to be activated and it needs to be made functional, but it has not been done. And so many other weaknesses are there. So the provincial governments, as you know, they are a very important link and a part of this National Action Plan. So the civilian, the provincial governments are also not working as they should, and they have not lived up to the expectations which were attached to them, or the tasks which were given to the civilian, to the provincial governments. That has not been done. So all this needs to be reviewed again. It needs to be revisited, and I believe that something should be done. I mean, the government must also reconvene a kind of review of this whole system. I mean, the National Action Plan, to what extent it has been implemented and what has not been achieved. So from time to time, we need to take a review of the situation. We need
Absolutely.
To revisit.
A periodical review is required.
Which has not been done. So that's one thing that is required, and I believe that the government should take immediate steps, or they should be able to do it. Otherwise, this whole effort which has been done in the past few years, 2.5 years, it will go waste. And the military and the security agencies, whatever they have done, whatever hard work they have done, and they have achieved, the peace and the security and stability in various parts of the country, there's a fear, there is a likelihood, and there is a apprehension that, you know, the whole thing can go waste. So therefore, it's very important for the civilian government to take stock of the situation, and should realize that without their role and the role that they have been assigned, if it is not done, then the whole effort will be wasteful.
Right.
So I think that it should be done, and the country is in the grip of, still it is in the grip of terrorism. We keep hearing from here and there, the intelligence sources tell us that efforts, terrorists have been apprehended, that they were planning to attack some organization, some installation, that explosives have been discovered from them. The truck that was there parked in Lahore and it exploded, you know, and these kind of things. So I believe that a very comprehensive plan, the National Action Plan, and all its aspects, all its segments need to be implemented with in letter and spirit. And all organizations of state which are involved and which were given the responsibility to act in coordination with each other, they must act in coordination. They must be on the same page. And we'll, only then we will be able to eliminate the menace of terrorism and extremism from the country.
Yes, that's very important, sir, being on the same page and interdepartmental cooperation and coordination, which you are saying it seems to be lacking after the events that we've witnessed.
Exactly.
Well, AVM Sub, moving forward, there's another aspect of the National Action Plan and also of our society where we have these groups or organizations that were periodically banned for being suspect or having some connections with militants. A lot of them were sectarian organizations. Again, they were banned, but then you noticed a phenomena where some of them changed their names and reemerged, and they kept doing that also despite the ban being in place. Now some of those parties are also entering into politics and becoming mainstream. Taliban are now printing a magazine, a women's magazine, for all that we know now. So how does that gel in with the National Action Plan? Are these welcome developments as a result of the action plan, or is something needs to be done about that?
You see, there are two aspects to it. Firstly, as long as these terrorist organizations continue to what they're doing, do what they're doing, then they continue to remain terrorists, and there is a need to continue the action against them. But if they are wanting to discontinue, abandon their terrorist activity, come into the mainstream, be political parties, and pursue their goals through peaceful means, through political means, that is good enough. But to be able to successfully implement all this, I think, as I said earlier, there is a dire need of developing national consensus on our narrative. And if that we can develop and pursue, our media takes it along, our politicians take it along, our political leaders take it along, and the general population accepts it, then I think we'll be able to eradicate these parties, terrorist groups who change their face, change their name, and want to blend in and continue their pursuit of terrorist activities. They will die their own death. But for that, we need to have a consensus national narrative, which is more important. And the people of Pakistan need to understand as to who are these people, what are their objectives, how they become against the national interest of Pakistan. But for that, there has to be a national narrative, which must be seen, understood, and owned by the people of Pakistan. Only then they will be able to
A lot of these organizations speak about the implementation of Sharia law. They talk about Islamic injunctions. They talk about being a sort of a religious force in the country for good. But the actions belie their words. But how do we deal with that situation? So where a number of these organizations are also involved in humanitarian work, especially when we see after natural disasters strike, a lot of them are actually doing humanitarian work for the people. So how do you deal with that sort of a phenomena where on the one hand they're killing people and on the other hand they're helping them when a flood comes around? So how does a normal citizen wrap his mind around that?
You see, the protection of life and property for every citizen is the primary responsibility of the government. And if a space is available in all in situations like national calamities, then these organizations will move in. They find an opportunity to undertake their charity work and to attract the attention of the people, attract their sympathies, and from sympathies they move on to support and even financial support and material support and even manpower support, and they gradually divert those people into their or adopt them or absorb them into their terrorist activities. So they must not be given that space. People of this country must be made to understand the actual and the true objectives and aims and designs of such like organizations, because they do not take time from switching from their charity work to whatever else that they were doing earlier on. And they must be allowed to work only in case their objectives are very clear, understood and allowed, because they are not invisible, they are very much visible. And if they are a banned organization, how are they allowed to work? They must not be allowed to work. And if there is a space, there is a vacuum in the efforts required to provide relief and rescue in any such calamity, that's the government's responsibility. It must call upon other institutions to lend a hand and provide the required support, and no space should be left for such like organizations to blend in and start their charity work in the garb of recruitment, in the garb of getting sympathies or support. So that must not be allowed to happen.
Right, but we do witness it happening all around us, AVM Saab. Javed Saab, in your opinion, the same question to you as well. When the militants or the terrorists talk about implementing Sharia, when they talk about implementing Islamic injunctions and laws, then the normal people would obviously, sort of gravitate towards that, because that is the basis on which Pakistan was created, was it not?
I think that needs to be clarified. And as has been pointed out by my colleague, that we need to build a national narrative on this.
Absolutely.
The constitution of Pakistan, under which we are now living and the state is being run, this is an Islamic constitution. The name Islamic Republic of Pakistan.
But then how do we have British laws in our Islamic constitution, sir?
No. But these are the laws which are used to punish people, and the courts are being run under that system. And there is no contradiction between these laws and the Islamic injunctions. So, and also it is provided in this constitution, the 1973 constitution, which was signed by all religious political parties, the JUI, the JUP, Jamaat-e-Islami, and all political parties which then existed in 1973,
right.
They all signed, and it is a consensus document. So Pakistan, for all practical purposes, is an Islamic state, and this constitution is also an Islamic constitution, and it is also provided in this constitution that anything that is repugnant to Islam can be deleted or can be done away with by the Parliament of Pakistan. And a lot of recommendations are there before the Parliament to consider and finally make these laws in accordance with the Islamic injunctions. So therefore, I think those people and those religious groups which keep crying for implementing Sharia law and Islamic law, they need to be told by these religious leaders, the JUI, the JUP, Jamaat-e-Islami and others, that this is an Islamic constitution, that this is an Islamic country, and that it is being run under an Islamic umbrella, and this constitution provides that. So they are trying to create misunderstandings among the people of Pakistan, as if we are a secular state, that the rulers of this country they're not Muslims, and it is provided in the constitution that no non-Muslim can be the president or prime minister of Pakistan. So this needs to be told to the people, and this misgiving and misperception which is being created by these extremist organizations like
there's the narrative of being more Muslim than
exactly,
the others.
More Muslim than
so
others.
How does one reconcile with that aspect? AVM Saab, if you'd like to also lean in on this, that when you start deciding who is more Muslim than the other person, isn't that where the friction and the problem begins to emerge?
As Javed Saab said, Pakistan is Islamic Republic of Pakistan. Its constitution is Islamic. And it becomes the responsibility of the government to make the people appreciate and realize and understand that it is an Islamic country. Anything and everything that we have in the country in terms of running the government, running the country, is Islamic. And in case there are any misgivings, any misunderstandings, misperceptions, then the constitution has provisions whereby requisite necessary amendments can be made. And we are a democratic country. And people have their elected representatives. They can bring in changes whatever they want to. It is available to them. It cannot be done through force. It cannot be done through coercion. There is a system available. And if these people, if they think there is something un-Islamic, they should get enough votes, go to the parliament and have the necessary amendments made and have the constitution amended the way they want to.
Right.
Provided they have that kind of strength in the parliament.
Absolutely.
So that system is available to them, and people must be made to understand this. Only then, you see, these people will...
So do you think that there would be cause now for example, if the Taliban decided to lay down their arms and become a political entity or become a political party, that they should be allowed to participate in the elections despite all the previous baggage that they carry of killing so many Pakistanis and so forth? Do you think that should be an option towards resolving this problem and eradicating terrorism from Pakistan?
You see, the world over, whenever such situations have reached that end where the armed or the militant struggle is discontinued, and those people who have been responsible for killing of thousands of innocent people have to acknowledge and admit their mistake, that this is what they did and this was wrong, and that they must apologize to the nation, and only then they should be allowed to come into the mainstream. Not that each one of them should be killed. No. I mean, that is how it happened in South Africa. Truth and reconciliation. So they have to admit their faults, they have to admit their mistakes, they have to admit killing so many people, and they have to apologize, and then they can be allowed to blend in, and they can go ahead and make a political party, carry out canvassing, and get votes, come into the parliament, and bring about changes if they can have that kind of majority. Only that is how I think it can happen. And eventually that is how it is going to happen. As and when, inshallah, when we reach that stage, when those terrorists are brought to a situation where they do realize that their game is over, and that they run away to some other place, or they want to remain here and be part of the society, this is how they will become.
Right. Javed Saab, moving forward now, we've spoken about the narrative, but unfortunately we haven't been able to clarify what the narrative should be. Every single television channel has been asked by Pemra to not show images of terrorists or not to glorify them and so on and so forth, and you have seen that being implemented by the TV channels. They have stopped showing yes. violence and so on and so forth. But again, the narrative that we're talking about seems to be missing from the national discourse. How do we, first of all, what is that narrative, and then what should be done in order to make that narrative more accessible to the public?
I think the primary duty is of the government of Pakistan and the representatives of the people of Pakistan, the parliament. And the religious parties, most of the religious parties in Pakistan who are also in politics, they are also political entities, and they get votes in the name of Islam. They are represented in the parliament. They all have condemned all forms of terrorism. Not only the government of Pakistan, non-religious parties like Muslim League, People's Party, PTI and others, they have also condemned it. But religious parties like Jamiat Ulama Islam, Jamiat Ulama Pakistan.
But speaking of PTI, they also have advocated that an office should be open for the Taliban and so on.
No, but later on they abandoned it. You know, in the initial stages, even the government of Pakistan under Nawaz Sharif, they were in favor of holding dialogue with Taliban and resolving this problem through a dialogue and negotiation.
Well, that failed miserably.
But failed, and so therefore they had to change the policy, and specifically after the APS attack in Peshawar, you know, the whole scenario changed, and they had to rethink their policy of negotiating with Taliban and extremists. So I believe that if religious parties, all religious parties from various, you know, hues and colors, they get together and they develop a narrative. I mean, at this moment, a broad consensus exists among all religious parties that terrorism and extremism is condemnable, and they have been condemning it, and they have been saying it very clearly and loudly that extremism and terrorism, violence, is not akin to Islam. It's not in accordance with Islam.
What about sectarianism, sir? Is sectarianism part of Islam?
No, it is not.
And so then we have a number, a plethora of these sectarian outfits operating under the umbrella
of
Islam.
It's very unfortunate.
So how do we deal with this, sir?
Some of these organizations, the sectarian political parties operating on Pakistan's soil, they were foreign funded, and they still are foreign funded. And a proxy war has been going on in Pakistan, and that proxy war has taken a lot of lives of the innocent citizens of this country. And some religious scholars had to, they were killed by these, proxy wars and these people who were being paid by foreign countries. And this is a well-known fact. So what is needed is that we need to put an end to this proxy war in Pakistan. We need to stop the money that is flowing into Pakistan and is reaching these organizations. That needs to be done. And the government of Pakistan...
And that is also part of the National Action
Plan. Exactly. And the security agencies need to take a strong action. Then we also announced, the government announced at one stage that hate material, the material that fans sectarianism and sectarian sentiments, we need to put an end to it. We need to curb all those activities which actually spawn sectarianism in Pakistan. And the printing of such material needs to be stopped. Some actions were taken, but they were half-hearted actions, and we still find that hate material in our
available.
Midst. So, and also, the people using mosques and other platforms, which are being used now to basically to fan the sectarian sentiments of people, and to actually intensify this war. That needs to be taken care of, and it is the responsibility of the security agencies of Pakistan, the intelligence agencies of Pakistan, the government of Pakistan, these federal and provincial governments. They must be very active on this count, and they must neutralize all these elements who are basically printing these kind of materials and the speeches which are, made on loudspeakers. There's a law that bans this the use of loudspeakers for these kind of speeches, but we still feel and we experience that loudspeaker is being used for these purposes. So these law enforcing agencies need to play a very important role, and they have to be very careful, and they need to address this situation. Any slackness on the part of the law enforcing agencies creates a lot of problem. So that's the responsibility of the government to put an end to it, the sectarianism.
Especially when we talk about the law enforcing agencies, their role, because they are the primary targets of the new wave of terrorism
exactly.
That has come out. AVM Saab, I'd like to share with you that there was a report in the press a few days back in which the terrorist organizations were apologizing to the people for... making them collateral damage, and now said that, we're not against you, we're against these organizations such as the military, the police, and law enforcement agencies that are operating in our country. They are now the stated targets of these terrorists. How do we deal with this new sort of phenomena or new threat that's emerging, in which they're trying to buy sympathy from the people by saying that, I'm sorry, you got killed, it wasn't intentional, we didn't mean to kill you. We was aiming for the, for the police van, which... If you see the kind of sympathy that is going to be generated through that sort of a narrative, isn't it very dangerous, sir? And if it is, then what needs to be done about it?
Well, I think it while you may call it dangerous, I think there is a ray of hope there. And that is like this, that there is a time when the narrative of these terrorist organizations was such that they had declared Pakistan... as a state of or a country of infidels, anybody and everybody was to be killed, and they could not or they would not differentiate between the security organizations or the intelligence organizations or the law enforcement agencies or the public.
So they, and everybody in the beginning they were aiming for mosques. Mosques were the primary target.
Anybody and everybody was legitimate target for them. And somehow, even at that time, we had sympathy in Pakistan, support in Pakistan, facilitation in Pakistan for these organizations, despite all this.
We still have facilitation, as you have seen in the Lahore case, sir, because obviously True. Without facilitation, it cannot happen.
But, of course, this facilitation has now
been reduced,
overwhelmingly curtailed. And it is very, very hidden, very, very secretive. Whereas earlier on, it was open, blatant. And, money used to be collected openly with these people. They were called jihadis. So now, when all these terrorist organizations have been forced to apologize, that means their narrative has lost. They have realized that they have lost public sympathy. Not just because they have been killing civilians, but the civilians have understood their game. They have understood their mindset. They have understood their purpose. Asanullah Ehsan has clearly narrated as to where they get the funding from. Who is behind them? Kulbhushan Yadav has clearly stated. So these two people have, further strengthened the building of or the development of new national consensus narrative. And they've helped us defeat the narrative of the terrorists. So now, when the terrorists make a statement and they apologize to the public, I think it is a ray of hope. Because it is a public, open acknowledgement of defeat by the terrorists. And it is open public acceptance of the success of the new emerging national consensus narrative of Pakistan. So I think there are better times ahead. I think we have covered a lot of distance. And the terrorists are at their fag end. Maybe a year or so, inshallah, hopefully, we'll get rid of them.
All right. I wanted to ask you, Javed Sahab, that do you think that the recent political turmoil that has engulfed our country, do you think that has also had an effect in diluting the civilian government's efforts towards fighting terrorism or implementing the 20-point national action plan in some way or the other? Or do you think that it is immaterial?
No, I think it has affected it because, the focus of the government was shifted from,
from doing their job to
survival. Taking care of terrorism and extremism and taking care of the security duties of the government and various organizations of the government, their focus was shifted towards fighting the legal battle in the Supreme Court and outside Pakistan, outside the Supreme Court, on the TV channels, on media, and even on the streets. So I think this was a distraction. It has hurt the effort, but the good thing is that the security agencies, the military and other allied security agencies, their focus was there, and they didn't deviate. And they didn't take their eyes off the activities of these organizations, and thankfully, they have done their job very well. And otherwise, the government was completely lost, and it was completely immersed in a new situation, and their focus was on fighting for survival. But now I think they should again focus on this activity of on the security of Pakistan. The life and the property of the citizens is the security of the life and property of the citizen is the primary responsibility of the government and the state, and they need to refocus on this now. The new government is there; it's functional, and I believe that they will now prioritize their activities and their duties and their functions. And and today the army chief met the prime minister, Mr. Shahid Khaqan Abbasi, and they discussed the scenario now, the security situation of Pakistan. And the other day, the core commanders meeting also assured the nation that they are not oblivious of the fact that Pakistan is now in the grip of terrorism and extremism, and it needs to be taken care of. And I believe that the security forces of Pakistan have not shifted their focus from that, and that's a good thing for the country.
And AVM Saab, speaking of the new Prime Minister, Mr. Shahid Khaqan Abbasi, he also spoke about terrorism and said that is on the priority of his government. He also had a meeting, or rather a telephone conversation with Ashraf Ghani, and that was a welcome sign. He also again reiterated his statement about cooperating with Afghanistan on the terrorism issue. How effective do you think the new government is going to be? In your opinion, do you think that the focus on fighting terrorism is renewed after the turmoil is over now? And do you think it's going to be positive?
You see, the world over, all political democratic governments have this activity at a very high priority, i.e. remaining in office, winning the next election. But while there are struggles going on everywhere, I mean, we often refer to Japan, where the average prime minister lasts not more than year and a half in last 25, 30 years. But still, they're developing. They continue to lead the world economies. So in our case, of course, it certainly has been a distraction. But the institutions are there. They continue to work. There are almost 15 to 20 subcommittees which are responsible for different action items of the National Action Plan. There's a Board of Governors of NECTA. So there are institutions already there in place, which despite whatever is happening at the political level, they are expected to continue to work without any disturbance, without any deviation, without any distraction, and pursue whatever mission has been given to them. But unfortunately, because there is a lack of oversight, the lack of supervision, lack of accountability, because the government is busy doing something else, so they, of course, they lose focus, and they do not pursue whatever they were tasked to pursue. So that probably has happened in last year and a half, ever since National Action Plan was made. And that is why we have not been able to achieve the required success or progress in the implementation of this National Action Plan. Now that we have a new Prime Minister, he has a clear field ahead, and the dust has settled. So it is expected that there will be wholehearted focus and oversight over all these subcommittees, all these institutions, all these boards of governors. And there will be greater involvement, participation, pursuance, and hopefully situations will improve. And it is good that he has spoken with the Afghan president just to renew the relationship between the two countries and the commitments and promises that they have made to each other. And it is expected that the situation will improve.
Let's hope for the best, sir. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for taking out the time and being on the show. Well, you heard the conversation, and in conclusion, we'd like to say that the government is doing its best in order to bring this menace of terrorism under control. We hope and pray that the government is successful in eliminating terrorism from Pakistan's soil forever. With that hope and on that note, it's goodbye.